Hey, more now on the federal government's major defence announcement, which will see Australia's military might significantly bolstered. Treasurer Josh Frydenberg is live in Sydney for us. Treasurer, good morning to you. Thanks for your time this morning. $38 billion, is it enough?
Well, obviously, it's an important and significant amount of money, but it's not the first nor the last contribution we'll be making to defence spending. And we'll obviously have even further announcements in the budget in just a few weeks' time, Carl, but we're lifting the size of our defence workforce by more than 18,000, taking it over 100,000 people at a cost of nearly $40 billion. And this is on top of the additional spending that we've done on the latest weapons systems and our major defence capability plan with new ships, new aircraft. And it does reflect the pretty uncertain and dangerous international environment that Australia now faces.
Well, it is all about tackling this uncertainty and perhaps flexing a bit of Australian might here as well on the international scale, Treasurer. But do we really think that this is going to have an impact on China? Will they really be shaking in their boots following this announcement?
Well, this is about Australia ensuring that we have the access to technology, that we have the access to defence equipment, and that we have the sufficient number of defence personnel to protect and advance our national interest. Now, Australia is just 26 million people. China, as you say, is a country of 1.3 billion people. But what we need to do is partner with our allies and friends, and that's why we're not just investing in hardware, we're also investing in the partnerships, the relationships, like through the AUKUS arrangement with the United States and the United Kingdom, like the Quad arrangement with Japan, with India and the United States, all of which put Australia at the top table with an ability to influence outcomes, to swap notes, and in the case of AUKUS, to exchange and access the best technology available.
The Treasurer, I think the point that Sarah makes is a good one. Xi Jinping is not going to be quaking in his boots, and he's not going to be worried about nuclear subs that are going to be built in 20 years. We've seen what's happened in Ukraine. No one's done anything about Russia. Everything that they're doing from a diplomatic point of view is not working. So how is this going to make any difference to how we're viewed worldwide?
Well, just to say that the Chinese and the Russians have had a thing or two to say about the AUKUS arrangement. They haven't been too pleased about that. So that is certainly on their radar, because what it does do is put Australia in partnership with two very important strategic allies in the United States and the United Kingdom. With respect to Russia, Carl, I do think the international efforts are having an impact. The Russian currency, the ruble, is in free fall. The stock market has closed. The Russian central bank can't access their $600 billion of foreign reserves. And the pressure is being put not just by governments, but also businesses. Google, Apple are withdrawing services. The big oil and energy companies are withdrawing their partnerships with Russian counterparts. Earlier this morning, I was on a call with my counterparts from the United States, the United Kingdom, Canada, and New Zealand, and we took a stock take of the measures that we have put in place collectively to put pressure to turn the screws on Putin and his cronies, and they are working. And there will be more measures that we will continue to take in partnership with the international community. It's very important that we are on the same page with like-mindeds in rejecting this unjustified use of force against 44 million Ukrainians.
Well, certainly the world's in agreement about this awful war and wanting it to stop. It's just about making it happen.
Well, the bombs are still coming. Yeah. I mean, they blew up a hospital, babies and women.
There's just no care given at all to those poor civilians. Now, let's just come back home, Treasurer, and I want to read you this tweet from local MP Justine Elliott, who says, Scott Morrison has announced that Ballina Byron and Tweed Shire residents will not be able to access the federal government's additional disaster payments. How is it that Ballina misses out, but locals in Lismore, 30 minutes away, don't? There's obviously seething anger out there, Treasurer, as you well know. Just how has this decision, you know, how did this come about, and why are some towns excluded?
Well, we have been providing support right across New South Wales and Queensland to flood-affected areas. That included those $1,000 one-off, non-taxable cash payments to adults, $400 to children, as well as the disaster recovery allowance, which allows up to 13 weeks of payments for people who can't access work. And then we've triggered with Queensland and with New South Wales broader payments to support small businesses get back on their feet. We know that in the area of Lismore it's been a catastrophic event, and the damage that we've seen there is greater than what we've seen in other parts of the country due to floods. So what we did is we sat down with the experts. They gave us the facts on the ground. We made the announcements yesterday, not just additional monetary support for households, but also support for businesses, mental health support, legal assistance, childcare support.
But Treasurer, sorry to interrupt, we're running out of time, but if you're saying to someone in Lismore who lost their house, you get an additional payment, but someone in Ballina who lost their house doesn't get that payment, it's just weird.
But we're going to continue to take the advice from the agencies about those most affected areas. But what we did do before announcing this, Carl, is we did sit down with the experts who had a good understanding of what is happening on the ground. This is not the first nor the last payment that we'll be making to support people in need in these flood-affected areas. As you know, we've got thousands of Defence Force personnel who are on the ground helping right now. And my thoughts are with obviously those families and businesses that have been impacted, but also a very big thanks to our selfless volunteers in the SES, as well as our Defence Force who are helping people in need.
All right. Treasurer, good to talk to you today. There's lots on there's lots still to come.
Thank you.
Appreciate your time.
Well, more on our top story now. And Australia's Defence Force is set to be significantly bolstered in its first major expansion since the Vietnam War. For more, we're going to bring in Nine political editor Chris Yuleman in Canberra. Chris, good morning. Good to see you. This is, of course, a big move by the Prime Minister, but it's not entirely unexpected.
I know, Sarah, this has been coming for some time, and the Prime Minister has been talking about the rising threat level for some time, and you could always usually in the past read that as code for China. Well, it's not code anymore. The Prime Minister has been quite explicit about the threat that's coming from China across all levels, really. It's not just the occupation and militarisation of the South China Sea. It's the information war which is already raging inside this country. The fact that we've had infiltration into our political parties, the fact that we have had problems in our universities, the fact that a lot of the Chinese language media in Australia is controlled from Beijing. All of that's going on right now. So when we're talking about modern warfare, we're not just talking about getting nuclear submarines or more guns or more boots on the ground. We're talking about a new kind of warfare and learning to fight it better.
Yeah, all of that bubbling in the background really, hasn't it, for the past few years. How will this announcement be received? I guess locally might be welcomed, most likely, but more importantly, internationally.
Well, I think we'll see the usual huffing and puffing from China, but one of the reasons that Australia is doing this is because that no country on earth is expanding its military more rapidly than China is. And we need to rise to meet that threat, and it is a real and present danger. Now, I don't think that Australia will face the threat of invasion in the way that we're seeing what's going on in Russia, but we do face other threats, and certainly in our region as we see China expand its bases and possibly move into the Pacific to our west. I think there's a reason why we're having to our east, I should say, there's a reason why we're having an East Coast nuclear submarine base, and that's because the threat will rise there.
Absolutely. There is a lot of uncertainty out there. And we know, obviously, you know, the Defence Force bolstering those numbers. We've been relying on the Defence Force these past couple of years here with COVID crisis, now obviously the flood crisis. Now, the PM's response, though, has come under heavy fire. He's accused of taking too long to act, hiding from the cameras as he toured flood-affected regions. Towns in northern New South Wales are missing out on additional disaster funding. There is a lot of anger out there targeted towards the Prime Minister.
Oh, look, I've got no doubt there is searing anger in that community about what's just happened, and the response hasn't been adequate, of course, according to a lot of people. But I would say this, there is no response that you could get that could get to everyone in those circumstances. And I don't think whoever is in government would have been able to act more quickly. I think one of the issues we do have to address is maybe we need a civil national defence force, because the Australian Defence Force really isn't set up for this kind of immediate emergency response. Now, that is changing. People are talking a lot about the National Declaration of National Emergency. Well, that's just a bureaucratic thing. That's to clear away red tape. that's more about the recovery than anything else. But of course, people will look at what some council areas, and three of them are getting more money now, and are getting, and say that they should get that as well. And no doubt the government will look at that and try and respond. But, you know, some of the anger that's directed at Scott Morrison is quite deserved. Some of the stuff that I've seen in the last 24 hours, though, is outrage that's been infected more from outside the community than what I can see from inside it.
Yeah, and I think the cutting of the red tape couldn't come soon enough. Chris, as always, thank you so much for your insight.
He knows his stuff, doesn't he?